had a dampening effect on the economy. Then we found that credit flows had dried up. Both external commercial borrowings, which our companies were having recourse to for expansion, because Indian interest rates were high, they preferred to borrow abroad, that suddenly froze. Export credits dried up. And then all the export-led industries were severely hit, which in India were quite often the labor-intensive industries of textiles, garments, gems and jewelry. All of them were impacted by the simultaneous constraint in demand in all three major markets, the US, Japan, and Europe. And as a result of this, coinciding with a tight monetary policy by the Reserve Bank of India to deal with inflationary pressures in India, which had constrained domestic demand, the Indian economy began to feel a little bit of constriction at that point in time. But the Indian government responded in a timely way to provide a domestic stimulus, not through increased spending, because we already had adopted a somewhat expansionary budget, but through tax cuts. Specifically, we had a 4% cut in value-added tax across the board and several excise duty reductions with a view to stimulating domestic demand and thereby regenerating momentum in the economy. There were also some targeted government procurement programs, and these have had the desired effect, as I said. We are seeing now a rebound in all the major industries, including cement, steel, aluminium, and automobiles, automobile components, consumer goods. In June, industrial production was around 8%. In July, around 6-point-something%. In August, 10%. Again, in September, it's close to 10%. So we are really seeing a rebound in industrial production. And that's been one of the interesting stories in recent years, the turnaround of industry in India and the fact that we are becoming competitive in manufacturing in certain niche areas. In the initial phase after liberalization, it was the services sector which grew and became the engine leading growth in the Indian economy, because this was the first sector which relied more on human capital and didn't require heavy outlays on infrastructure, and it was able to link up with the global economy, particularly US companies and US firms. And through this linkage, they were able to drive growth in the Indian economy. But our industry, which was sheltered behind high tariff walls domestically and through a very elaborate system of regulation and licensing, was really not competitive. And when we opened up to the global economy, many of them were afraid that they would sink. And in fact, they criticized the government, saying, "You are forcing us to run before we have learned to walk." But in the event, this put pressure on our industry to modernize and to revitalize themselves. And in recent years, I think what India is increasingly bringing to the table is the ability for high-tech, low-cost manufacturing. We've seen it in the case of the nano car, which is the smallest, cheapest car, not smallest, but small, cheapest car in the world, which will be sold at an average price of $2,500. And it's a marvel of engineering because everything had to be small, it had to be cost effective. So this whole concept of what somebody has described as frugal engineering is what the nano represents. You've seen it also in the moon mission, more sophisticated, where India was able to undertake the Chandrayaan moon mission at 1/6 the cost that similar missions have been launched elsewhere. Similarly, in the field of atomic energy, which was referred to, I think India is the most cost-effective producer of small atomic nuclear power plants. In the 500 megawatt range, perhaps we are the most competitive. The latest addition that we built indigenously to Tarapur was built without time and cost overruns. So this is something new that we are bringing to the table. Apart from the expansion of the knowledge economy beyond information technology and information technology enabled services, we have expanded into areas such as biotechnology, pharmaceuticals, chemicals, and in all these areas, which also find a home in Alabama, I think the opportunities for cooperation between our two countries and between India and Alabama in particular are quite immense.